So, for scientific computing, is this thing for me, containers? And my opinion is that yes, it is, for sure. Because many of the things that led to the development of, for instance, Docker, also apply to scientific computing. We have a very heterogeneous environment in scientific computing. That also happens in the industry. We have notebooks, desktop, farms, clouds, HPC, whatever. And we use very frequently different flavors. In a certain system, we have a certain flavor. In our desktop, we have another flavor, and so forth. And then we need very frequently different compilers and library versions than ones that are packaged in the operating systems, the distributions, and so forth. So this leads to a very heterogeneous environment. And running a complex application somewhere very frequently requires a lot of effort. And then there is another thing, which is the syndrome of, okay, I was running this 6 months ago, and now I'm trying to run it and does not run. Something has changed. Something was upgrading in the operating system, whatever, and you cannot no longer run your application. And containers solve all those problems. So we need a consistent, portable way of running applications, and containers can be a good solution for that. But there is always a but here. One of the problems is that, of course, many of these functionalities that I mentioned require root privilege. Either to install the system, which requires the cooperation of system administrators that are known to be annoying and do not deploy the things that we need, or to set up the system, or to run, or to do all these things. And then some things like Docker have a few issues. For instance, in the case of Docker, if you have access to the Docker API that you need to have to run things, basically, with this access to the API, you can do anything, and you basically can take control of the host system, which is not nice. So this is good to run in your own desktop. This is good to run in a cloud environment where you control the machines. Or if you are just if you are a system administrator, kind of system administrator that wants to exhibit a system to the outside world, a service to the outside world, but giving control to this basically gives control to the host system. So there is a problem in there. Basically, when you are running inside a container, in Docker, in many of these systems, is a bit like, okay, at a certain moment, you have root privileges to do at least the setup of the container. So you are the whole powerful wizard. And then use a lot of technology, and that's why you are using SecCamp, and you are using SLinux and other things to try to restrict the powers of the root. Because if it gets out of the container, well, he's master. So we can, or at least some people argue that the security model is a bit flawed because it comes from the Unix security model. But it's a bit flawed in the sense that a good security model, you should start without privilege. And you just get the privilege to do the task that you need to do. And here is a bit the opposite. To do, even to start something, you need to have basically all privileges, and then you try to cut it. And this is bound to be trouble, usually. So, another tool is Udocker. Udocker is more interesting in this aspect. It was born in the Indigo Data Cloud project that just finished last September. The objective of the project was to develop what is usually called in the cloud environment as a PaaS, platform as a service. Basically, the idea was to provide an environment that enabled you to run on clouds, on eventually on farms and things like that in a very transparent way. So you would run scientific applications through this system in several types of resources without having to change your applications. That's the whole concept, basically. You don't need to know more about that. But an important thing is that one of the technologies that we decided to use to do the encapsulation of the applications so that they could run across all these heterogeneous environments is Linux containers, namely Docker, because it's the industry standard. So with Udocker, we have this challenge that okay, Docker is very nice, that's true. It runs very well on the desktop, it runs wonderfully in the cloud, but then is meant to be mostly run by people with privileges, and then we have all the security issues, but we want also to run on batch systems and interactive Linux systems where you are a normal end user without privileges and you would like to run a container there so that you could run your application without having to recompile things and without having to ask for the system administrator to install new compilers and new libraries and stuff like that. And so we started to investigate how we could do this, and we came out with some answer to this question, whether we can run containers, Docker containers without Docker. And yes, we can download the images from Docker Hub. We can run them somehow without this strange layer of Docker, or let's say dealing with it. And we can run as normal user, and we can run almost like in Docker enforcing the container metadata that is defined for the container. And how we'll see how. But basically with UDocker, you can run the applications encapsulated in Docker containers without using Docker actually, without even being present, without using any type of privilege as a normal user, without system administrator intervention, and without additional system software. And you can run as a normal user and have the same process controls and accountings as you normally have. So you can run in batch systems, in HPC systems, or whatever. It is available as open source in GitHub. If you want to try it, it's available here under the Indigo DC organization, UDocker. You just search for it in Google or something, and you will find it. It became quite popular. It is more than 200 stars now on GitHub. And basically, it's very easy to use. The most easy thing to do is just to get the Docker Python script to your machine like this with a curl command. You just get UDocker. You change the protections of UDocker because it's a Python script. You just run UDocker install. This takes just a few seconds. It does not compile anything or whatever. It just fetches a few executables that you need, and you are set to go. And then it has a syntax that is the same of Docker. So there are a lot of people that are using this now to replace Docker in certain circumstances where they cannot not run Docker. So usually taking this U here of UDocker, you could do the same with Docker. So this is the same as a Docker pool of Ubuntu 14.04, and it will download the layers of Ubuntu. So it will store, like in Docker, the image locally, and then you can see that you have the image downloaded with your Docker images. So that's the same command as in Docker, Docker images. Then you can take an image and extract it to the file system with UDocker create. That's the same thing that Docker does. You can do exactly the same thing with Docker. And then you get something that is extracted and that you can actually run. So you get a file system tree within your home directory somewhere and a dollar home UDocker with the container ready to be run. And you can see that the container is there. Has a certain ID and a certain alias, and then you can run it. So I'm running Ubuntu 14, and what you will see is this basically, and since it's an Ubuntu 14, you are at the prompt then by default. If you don't have, if the container does not have any command to be run, then it starts a shell. And you can see that is Ubuntu, that is Ubuntu 14, and you even can install software. You are Ubuntu 16 and 14, and you can do an apt get install Firefox, and it will install Firefox. And if you run Firefox in there, it will run Firefox. And answering to your question, it will run with acceleration. Because here I'm running as a normal user. I'm actually not using namespaces. I'm not using all that fancy stuff that requires privileges. In this mode, I'm running as a normal user, and everything runs, and you can do most of the things that you will do, even install software that usually is something reserved for the system administrator. This is another example, but here I don't want to run as if I was a root. I want to run as George, and I want to mount my home directory from my host inside of the container. I want to define some environment, and I want that my working directory by default is my home directory, and okay, I'm in there, and I can run as a normal user. And my home directory will be visible inside of the container. So how does this work? This is something implemented in Python, C, and C++, and there are some things that are in Go. It can run basically everywhere, but it has been tested on CentOS 6, CentOS 7, Fedora several versions, Ubuntu 14, Ubuntu 16, Ubuntu 17, also in some Debian versions. It should work in basically everywhere. Depends also on the execution modes that you will see. It provides a command line interface like Docker. It pulls containers from Docker Hub using the RESTful API from Docker Hub. And then it manages the local repository of images and containers. Basically, when we interface with the Docker Hub, we pull the layers of the images into the local file system, and then we unpack them into a certain target directory. And once they are unpacked in a certain target directory, we can do a change root-like operation to that target directory and run in that environment. That's the way it works. But I'm not using change root, okay? I'm using other strategies that do not require privileges. Actually, UDocker is not about one type of technology. It uses a lot of different types of technologies that you can opt. So by default, when you start UDocker, a container is running this mode that uses ptrace and seccomp to filter system calls, intercept those system calls, and change them on demand. And all system calls that invoke path names, those path names are translated so that they go into the container directory, root directory. Okay, so do path name translation on demand, and that's what enables us to run without namespaces and without mounting stuff in the container. Another completely different method is, for instance, RunC, that actually uses rootless namespaces, which is a bit of a different type of namespaces, but it is only available in very recent kernels. So if you have Ubuntu or something like that, you can run any container with this RunC mode that is based on the Open Containers project. And we package everything together, pyroot, RunC, or whatever, inside UDocker. Another mode of execution that is becoming more and more faster and more interesting is this fake change root system that we are changing it heavily, and that allows to do system call interception at level of library calls. And we can do the same translation, but instead of doing the translation at the level of the system call, we do the translation at the level of the library call. And then the last system that we use is Singularity. Singularity is a system that allows also to do a change root, basically, and we can run with Singularity. So if Singularity is available there, UDocker will run the containers transparently with Singularity as well. You just choose. Some ideas of performance. This is an MPI application running in 250-260 cores, and we can see basically that running with UDocker in these several places has the same performance or better performance than the host system. And you say, better? How is this possible? Very easy. The HPC systems are typically CentOS 6. CentOS 6 is not such optimized. And if you build a container with another operating system, for instance, with Ubuntu or CentOS 7, things will go faster. It's as simple as that, because the compilers are more optimized, the libraries are more optimized, and you can get more performance from the same host system. Another example here with biomolecular complexes, the DSVs application from life sciences, and we can see this is the performance of the host. And this is the performance running with Docker, real Docker, here as well, and the performance running with UDocker. That is better. So in many circumstances, UDocker will be even faster than Docker. And here we are using OpenCL and NVIDIA GPUs in this application to do acceleration. And then we have other examples, but I will not go because we are already short in time. I think I will finish. Yes. This is just an example of running one very complex application that is master code. And this is an application that merges a lot of legacy code in Fortran and other languages. And to compile these with all the dependencies and make it run is non-trivial. And one way of running this is with UDocker. So they built a container, and running it, it becomes very easily. You just obviously have to fetch UDocker and run UDocker like this, mounting certain volumes inside of the container, and then running. So there are plenty of advantages for using containers, easy packaging. If you are using Docker or UDocker, you get access to these very well-defined formats of container images that is becoming a standard. Easy distribution and sharing because you have Docker Hub and you can pull containers from Docker Hub. You can upload containers to Docker Hub as well and create your own containers and share them with your friends. You get isolation from changes in the host environment, so no longer need to bother with system administrators. You have this principle of creating containers once and then run them whenever you want. So you create them now, you run them in 1 year, and it will run independently from the changes in the underlying operating system. You have a base for reusability, because once you create a container, you can create new containers using the one that you created as a basis. And you can also get better security, because you can have isolation. And also, this enables virtualization with low overhead. So it's a win-win situation for everybody. So I think this is a very interesting application, a very interesting tool for scientific computing. Another one is obviously preservation. You want to preserve things, and you want to run them years later. And since this is stored in this format, that are basically tar files, in fact. This is very easily preservable. And that's it.